Hello, welcome to module number 2 of microscopy lecture series, which we covered for the University of Texas Dallas summer 2018 microscopy workshop. In this lecture, what we'll be discussing about are parts of microscope. And by the way, my name has not changed, it is still the same. So there are two kinds of microscopes. One is a good one and one is a bad one. Just kidding. The good one are of two types, either inverted microscope or an upright microscope. If it's a inverted microscope, this has got the objective sitting underneath the stage. And why do we have such a design? So that you can put any sample without shaking it too much. Like if you have a lot of buffer in the sample, for example, if you have sample which is a live sample, which needs some kind of a buffer or some kind of a medium in which it can stay alive, then you can use this kind of a microscope. This is usually seen in the tissue culture of a typical lab. On the other hand, this microscope is very useful when you have like a dead sample, like a fixed slide. You can easily put it in here and visualize from the top. So both have their own advantages and disadvantages. You can choose whatever works for you. Okay. So a lot of people have been using this microscope because this is one of the heaviest used microscope in our facility. It's a slide scanner. The question for you is it upright or inverted? I will give you a couple of seconds to guess. If you can guess it right, I will give you a chocolate. You can come down and take it from me. Okay, anyway, so if you see here, let's open it up. So there's a cover here, you can flip it up and you can see the objectives here, which has got a slide holder where you can put the slide. There's a robotic arm which takes the slide and puts it up here, and the light source is sitting behind here and the camera is here, so it's an upright microscope, right? And of course, you should always try to open these kinds of covers so that you can be getting a better understanding of what kind of microscope is it. That way you can, in future, if you choose to design some kind of microscope or if you want to troubleshoot, you have a better idea, right? But of course, don't open up these screws because that way the microscope might stop working and you will be also in a problem and I will also be in a problem. So just be curious enough, but not too curious, okay? Great. So, what are the different kinds of parts of a microscope and how do they look? So, this is a light path of a typical epifluorescence microscope, and if you can see here that there is a light source sitting here and there's a filter set here. Why do we need a filter set? So, for example, the screen that which from which you are visualizing this image is composed of white light, right? The LED source or the LCD, whatever you have, the screen is a white light source. On the other hand, if you want to see the red color here, green color here, that is done based upon the liquid crystals in the screen or the LED display itself, right? Whatever the screen it is. If it's a CRT, then it's a different case, but yeah, the whole idea is that the screen is composed of three colors, RGB. And different combinations of that is giving you these colors. So same way, the white light that is coming out of this source is filtered out into a wavelength packet or whatever band pass what you want, and is sent in into the dichroic mirror. It sends it up into the object so that you can excite it and then collect it back into the camera through this filter. So why do we have the dichroic mirror here? Why can't we place the light source right up here? The answer is simple. Because if you have light coming in straight like this, then you need to align both the lenses properly, number one. Number two, it's easier to focus on the same spot using the same lens. It will be difficult if you have two different lenses. And third one is because the objective is very, very close, and hence then optical resolution that you can achieve using this method is going to be higher compared to what you can achieve using this straight illumination using a condenser. You'll be getting to know that better once we discuss about the numerical aperture in the coming slides. But for now, let's assume that this is going to be better. Great. So what are the different kinds of light sources? We'll talk about that in the next slide. So if you see here, the light source that our microscopes have are like a slide scanner has got a LED light source. So this is a great source because the spectrum in which it can emit the light is going to be very broad, as well as it's a very fast source of light, meaning it doesn't take much time to switch on and off, just like your computer screen. On the other hand, if you see the age-old light sources, which were like metal halide lamps or mercury arc lamps, or even this projector that you have on your over your head, it takes little while to switch on and little while to switch off, right? Mm-hmm. We don't want that, because nowadays we are microwave generation, we want everything fast. So this LED source can do really fast switch on and off cycles, number one. Number two, their lamp hours are very, very long, like 10,000 hours, 20,000 hours. So you can do your entire PhD using one light source and then be done with it, okay? Great. On the other hand, we have solid state lasers as well for confocal microscopes. These are like laser lines, very sharp lines, like 2 nanometer, 3 nanometer bandwidth. So they can also be used for excitation. They are also instant switch on and off, so really good for use. And lastly, for two photon microscopy, we have pulsed laser sources. These are a little expensive, like $200,000 each, because they are pulsed and they are tunable. They can be tuned anywhere from 700 to 1300 nanometer, depending upon the laser source. There are two kinds of laser sources that we have. One is a titanium sapphire laser, which has got a bell-shaped curve, is much more powerful in a short area. But if you want a steady emission in the entire regime, then InSight laser is going to be much better useful. We have both so that we can use both of them simultaneously. And of course, this is going to be producing, like I forgot to discuss that in our first a module, that the peak power, or like the laser power total wattage, is about 2-3 watts or 5 watts maximum. But because this is a pulsed laser source, so each pulse can be of a few hundred femtoseconds or picoseconds, and hence all the energy can be compressed into that short excitation, and hence that power can go as much high as 150 kilowatt. So that's a lot of power. And if you have a continuous power of that energy, then this entire building will blow away. So that's how the molecule is excited in two photon regime, by having so intense laser energy in one spot at that instant. And of course, that power is not continuous, and that's why the sample doesn't burn out. But there have been instances where the sample burns out, because even IR infrared light is too hot for the sample, and that's why in my previous institute there was a microscope called Bheja Fry, which means brain and fry. So basically they were frying brain slices, or another one was called Fly Fry, because they were imaging Drosophila using a two photon microscope, and they used to fry the flies. So anyway, so jokes apart, this is the light path of a confocal and a two photon are different. So in a confocal microscope, like we have discussed before, the light comes into a laser, into the scanning mirror set, and is put onto the sample. What does the scanning mirror do? So the scanning mirrors, if you can remember when you were a small child, you would be using a mirror and then shining the sunlight coming from a window into your brother or sister's eyes, right? It was a lot of fun. So same thing we do here. We have a mirror here which can scan in X and Y on this sample. That way you can raster scan around the object here and then get the image here on the pinhole. And these mirrors are before this dichroic, and hence they can de-scan, because they are going to move the beam back and forth, and whatever is being collected will be collected in such a way that it is always focused on the detector. So this method process is called de-scanning. And the scanners can be of two types, resonant scanner or galvano scanner. Resonant one is very fast, but of course, because if you are doing a fast scan, so you will be getting a better temporal resolution, but a poorer signal to noise. If you want a prettier image, you have to go for a galvano scan. And here you can see the light passes through and is what is used on the other detector, so that you can get a transmitted light image. Okay. On the other hand, here in a two photon microscope, as you can see, the excitation happens only on the spot here, right? Nowhere else, like here. So there is no need of getting rid of the out of focus light, and hence there is no pinhole here needed. Further, you don't want to lose light using these scanning mirrors, because the light amount that is coming out is really scarce. So that way the scanning mirror is kept away, and hence the light directly goes through the into the detector, and that's why it is called non-descanned detector. You'll be coming across in two photon literature a lot. Okay, so that way you can get a one plane image using this two photon microscope. Now the question comes, what are these filters out actually made out of? How can they separate two colors and things like that? So that's a really cool idea. So let's see how it is done. So if you are a UTD student, then this building might be familiar to you. The tiles here don't have any color actually. Did you know that? Even the peacock feather or the fly or this fish or this butterfly, none of them have their own color. They all work based upon interference. How does that work? So if you have monochromatic light coming in, you can see these Newton's ring diffraction patterns that are forming. On the other hand, if you are using a white light, then you can see these beautiful colors. How is this done? So on a metal sheet like this, you deposit a thin layer of transparent material so that the incident light comes in, passes through, out like this. And there's a path difference between the two lights which are reflected from the top and from underneath. And hence, whatever, if say suppose the path difference is equal to the wavelength of light, then there will be constructive interference. If they are 180 degree out of phase, then there will be a destructive interference. So for example, in this area, all the red light is destructively interfering, and here all the blue light is destructively interfering, and hence the complementary color is visible. Great. So that's the principle on which you can see different colors here. How do we apply that to real world interference filters? So we have multiple layers, like 6-7 layers of refractive index changing materials, and hence you can actually achieve these kinds of sharp optical properties, like sharp changes in transmittance as a function of wavelength. And using this, you can actually create a long pass filter, meaning like the longer wavelengths can pass through, a band pass or a short pass, or have beautiful properties like multiple band passes here using just one material, right? So that's so amazing. And all these lasers can be put in such a way that the laser is reflected, whereas the light, which is the fluorescence, can pass through. Good. So now the question comes, how do we make sure which filter to use, and what are the nomenclatures based upon which you can choose which filter to use? So answer is simple. So this is the excitation spectrum and emission spectrum of the dye of your choice. In this case, I'm taking just one example. You can have multiple dyes. For this simple case, what you want is a filter such that the light is exciting your sample. So you will be using a band pass filter in the excitation regime 480/40x for Alexa 488. Similarly, you have to use a different filter for a different dye. So what does this mean is that 480 is the midpoint and 40 is the band band size, and x comes from excitation, ex. On the other hand, similarly for emission, you have m, 535/50 m. Okay, so that way you can get a very filtered out light, and here T 510 means like the transition happens, the midpoint, the inflection point is at 510. So the light comes in, passes through and excites the molecule, reflects, and then emission is here. So if you put it together, that's how it looks like, that the light comes in, goes through, and then excites, and then comes out, and this is how it looks like. Of course, the question people ask is that, can I interchange the filters if I don't have excitation filter? Can I use an emission filter which has got similar properties? The answer is yes and no, because for excitation, the light that is coming in is of milliwatt power, whereas the emission is of microwatt power. So the filter here is designed in such a way that it can withstand a lot of light and hence will have lesser transmittance compared to the one which is here. So definitely you can potentially use this one here, but not the other way around. It will burn out, okay, or it will not work properly. So here's the design of a quad triple band pass filter. You can see 1, 2, 3 colors it can image simultaneously. So there are examples which can also do quad band pass filters, but as the number goes higher, the capability to separate between the colors become difficult, so you have to choose wisely. Here is an example of a typical scenario which is called crosstalk or bleed through. What it means is that when there are two dyes which are very very close by, for example here Alexa 488 and 546, their spectra overlap. Hence, if you excite one, you are going to excite other one also, or if you are collecting one, you are going to potentially collect the other one also. So if you have a same excitation for both the fluorophores, then it is called crosstalk. If you are collecting here and you are collecting from both, it is called bleed through. So you have to choose the right filters so that you can get rid of this. Of course, if you are if you can avoid this situation, that's the best thing, but you cannot always avoid. So what best you can do is to either do a sequential imaging, meaning you excite here only and collect here only, excite here only and collect here only. That way you can get rid of this problem. And all the high-end microscopes are capable of doing that, and all the epifluorescence microscopes are intrinsically designed in such a way that they always do sequential imaging. They cannot do parallel imaging. But always it's a good idea to choose a better filter or a better dye. Okay. And this will be very important, because if you are doing a co-localization experiment and the molecule A and molecule B are labeled with these two colors, you might get a false co-localization which you don't want, right? So always try to keep these two colors wide apart. So though the filters which we saw so far are like fixed filters, they cannot be varied over time because they are designed in such a way. On the other hand, there are high performance filters which can be tuned. For example, this one AOTF, Acousto Optical Tunable Filter, it can be used to tune what light is going to come out. So you can have multiple colors coming in. This is a tellurium oxide crystal, and there's a piezoelectric system set up here which can produce diffraction, like vibrations in the crystal, and which is going to create a crystal width of different sizes, and which is going to allow or diffract a light of a given type. That way you can control the frequency of light that is coming out as well as the intensity. So this is the filter that is used in the microscope to quickly switch between two different colors. On the other hand, for detection part, again we have a diffraction grating, and there's a pinhole or a slit through which the light can pass through, and this slit is adjustable, and hence you can flexibly select which wavelengths do you want. picture here is depicts that these band passes can actually be changed according to the need. So quite often there will be like the molecule that you want to image will be preloaded into the software, but there will be cases where there will be newer dyes which may not be in the software. So it's always a good idea to know spectrometrically what are the spectra of the dye and then accordingly choose the right filters, because at the end of the day what you want is a great image. But if you choose a poor filter selection, then you may get a crappy image, number one. And even if you manage to get the right image, and if you say suppose published, the worst news would be that oh, it was a false colocation because of poor filter choices. So make sure that you choose the right filters and right sequence imaging method. For example, here the green and red cannot be imaged together because there's an overlap here, you see. But if you do a sequential, you can get rid of the bleed through. Great. So now what are the different kinds of objectives and what are their parameters there? So if you see any objective, there's a lot of scriptures written here. These are Chinese scriptures. Just kidding. Yeah, these are English, and mostly they contain information about different kinds of parameters about the objective, like manufacturer, what is the magnification, what is the numerical aperture, what kind of immersion medium you should use, some special optical properties, what is the working distance, what is the cover slip thickness that you can use, and etc. So for you, most important would be numerical aperture, because that is going to define the optical resolution, and also the immersion medium, because that is going to determine whether you are going to get a great image or not. And cover slip glass thickness, usually every cover slip thickness is like this, but of course you have to make sure that it is number 1.5 or 0.17, because most of the objectives are designed for this kind of a cover slip thickness. If you use the wrong one, then you can lose as much as 80% of light intensity. So make sure that you have the right thickness. So here is an example of what is numerical aperture. So what it means is that how much amount of light can the objective collect. If it is really far away, then the angle is going to be small, and hence the light amount that is going to be collected will be small. As you come closer, the amount of light that you can collect is more and more, and hence you can get a better resolution. We'll be talking about that in the coming few slides on how the NA is going to define the optical resolution. Now the question comes, a lot of people ask me, like, why do we need to use oil on the microscope objective? Can't we just image it just like that? It becomes so sticky, so oily. The answer is not to lubricate the slide, but to actually make sure that most amount of light is captured by the objective. Here is an example. If your sample emits light, it is going to pass through the immersion oil and go into the lens, right? So you want to keep the refractive index of both the things similar so that there is no bending of light and no loss of light. On the other hand, if say suppose you used water or silicon oil or air, then some of the light is going to go into the lens, but most of the light here is going to total internally reflect back, and hence you are going to lose this information. And the wider angle light is the one which contains more information about the optical resolution. So if you lose that, then you are going to have a lesser resolution. So you are going to get dimmer images as well as a pathetic resolution. So always use the right immersion medium. And if you have like a silicone oil, don't use different immersion oil, because that is going to cause spherical aberrations. We'll be talking about that in the next slide. So what are the different kinds of optical aberrations that can happen? So different wavelengths of light have got correspondingly different refractive index for glass, and hence they will focus at different positions in the optical axis. How do we correct that? So if you take a normal image, you can see this area like a blue and this area is red. That's an example of chromatic aberration. In order to correct that, we can use a lens doublet. One lens will be having a property like this and another will be reverse, so that way they can focus on two colors. If the third color is to also focus, then you have to use multiple lenses in conjugation with each other, such that you can correct for all the three colors. Of course, these kinds of objectives are going to be more expensive and heavier, and will be allowing lesser amount of light. So most of the objectives are designed in this way, so you don't have to worry about that. But if you at all see these things, then you have to understand that it is coming either from the objective or from the sample prep itself. But in case if you see, let us know. What is spherical aberrations? Spherical aberration happens when the light coming from different parts of the lens cannot be focused at the same spot. This usually happens when you are using a incorrect refractive index of the medium, or you are using a wrong cover slip thickness. There's a way to correct for that. There's a correction collar here which you can adjust. But of course, however hard you focus, if you cannot find the right, like a focused image, it's happening because of spherical aberration. So here are a few examples of different kinds of lenses which have got different properties. Like this one is air objective, this one is oil objective, and this one is a silicone oil. Why was this objective invented? It's because the refractive index of our tissue is typically close to 1.4. It is far away from this one and very, very far away from this one. So if you are trying to image inside a tissue using an oil immersion objective, you are going to get spherical aberration. On the other hand, in silicone oil, you are going to get a tight spot. That's how silicone oil is going to give you deeper images, like you had already seen in the case of two-photon imaging, that silicone oil could actually give you like 1.5 times better resolution at the depth, right? So that's how we can correct for spherical aberration. So with that, we come to the end of module number 2. In module number 3, we'll be discussing about detectors and practical aspects.